from home. Here I come here. So I'm going to talk about the origins of music in a developmental sense today. So I'm going to think about where music comes from in terms of development, the earliest experiences we have with music and the effects that music has on us. And just to sort of set the stage for that, not only is music a universal across cultures, but singing to infants is universal across cultures. And so it's kind of interesting when you think about it, why do we sing to infants? Why do infants care about music? There have been a lot of studies done on infants' preferences, and infants prefer higher pitch singing, higher pitch infant-directed speech. They like loving tones of voice. They like simple structures. And in studies we've done over the years, we've shown that parents don't just sing in one way to the baby, but they sing in different ways depending on the context. So they'll sing lullaby-like things to put the babies to sleep, they'll sing play songs to rouse their babies and get them interested in interaction. What's the function of these? Why are mothers doing this? Well, probably because of probably serves emotional communication, social interaction needs of the infant. So we kind of view music as coming from basic development, that it's one part of the infant's development and a very important part, and that's what I'm going to try to convince you of during the talk. The overview of what I'm going to do, I'm going to start with studies of rhythm and movement in infants, actually adults and infants, and then I'm going to move to pitch-based studies. So we're going to look at how infants process rhythmic structure, temporal structure, and how they process spectral or pitch structure. And then hopefully at the end I'll have time to tell you about some specific effects of specific experience on how the brain gets wired up. Okay, well in some sense rhythm is more basic to music than pitch. Because you can imagine, in fact we do have music that doesn't have pitch, but it's hard to imagine music that doesn't have a temporal structure. So perhaps rhythm is sort of the more basic aspect of music, and then from that sense you might expect it to develop. Earlier, it might have a longer evolutionary history, and so let's think about where it would have come from. Well, it's not a new idea that musical rhythm probably came from rhythmic body movements. And so we're going to explore that. We all know that musical rhythm makes us move. And that suggests that there are strong multisensory connections between auditory areas and movement areas in the brain. And again, that's not a new idea. But if you think in terms of development or if you think in terms of evolution, if you think that movement was primary, movement came first, then what you might, we all know that music makes us move, but perhaps the opposite is true as well, that the way we move affects how we hear. Okay, so if you're going to if you think about it in that sense, you might want to ask that second question. And so that's what we set out to do in a series of studies that we conducted with Joseph Phillips, who was my grad student at the time, and he's now at Moms. So we thought about, thinking about how to do this, we decided to take advantage of the fact that we can have ambiguous rhythms. Now, what do we mean by ambiguous rhythm? Well, we all know in the visual domain we can have ambiguous figures. So you can see this either as two white faces or a single black boss, and you can go back and forth between those ambiguous, between those two interpretations, and we call that an ambiguous stimulus. We can have the same thing in a rhythm pattern, so we can have a pattern that's 6 beats long, and you can interpret it either as two groups of three, or as three groups of 2 beats. And so because you can interpret it either way, it's an ambiguous pattern. And in fact, when you listen to it, it's hard to hear it in both ways at the same time. And just as an example, Leonard Bernstein, in West Side Story, with the song I Like to Be America, he alternates every bar, he alternates back and forth between these two interpretations. I'm talking to large music people, so you have to bear with me. I often give this talk to people who are not musicians, and then I have to explain things a little bit more difficult. so we decided we took our cue from that, but we used a simple rhythm pattern that sounds like this when it has no accents. And then we asked them, what did you hear? And so we gave them trials where we presented the rhythm with the accents now every second beat, or accents every third beat. And depending on how they were bounced, if they were bounced every second beat, they said the pattern sounded like that one, we chose that one. And if they were bounced every third beat, they said that's what they heard. So in other words, we were able to bias their interpretation of this ambiguous pattern by how we moved them. So the way you move affects what you hear. And music teachers know this because they get their students to move. They have trouble with a rhythm pattern, they often get them to move, to feel the music. And then they can auditorily understand it as well. And we did control condition because when you're moving, of course, you're moving through a sound field. So there may be some auditory cues there. The sound will change slightly as you move through the sound field, but you get the same results with headphones. However, you don't need to see, because when you move up and down, of course, there are visual cues there as well. Right? So the objects are moving on the retina, and there's visual flow cues and so on. But blindfolded, you still get the effect. So you don't need to be able to see. There doesn't need to be any visual influence. However, when we had people just watch someone else move, we didn't get the effect. So there was something about the movement itself that was really important. Now, these were non-musicians, for the most part. Maybe musicians would have gotten some transfer, but we didn't have any transfer in the non-musician. Okay, so the question then is, how early do these multi-sensory connections develop? If you think about it, across cultures, infants experience concurrent movement and singing every day of their life. Okay, so when mothers are singing to them, they're rocking them in time to the music, they hear their mother's footsteps as they're being held and walked by their parent. They hear the footsteps which are happening, the sound of the footsteps is happening in a correlated manner with how they're being moved up and down. So all through sort of their life, they're experiencing concurrent sound and movement in a correlated fashion. So you might think that maybe these systems would become wired together. And what do we know about infants' perception of rhythm? Well, they show very early abilities in terms of rhythm. Baruch and Drake showed back in 1997 that infants show optimal temporal discrimination at the same range as adults, around 600 milliseconds. So that's when you can discriminate one speed from a slightly different speed. You're best at doing that around 600 milliseconds onset to onset beats, and infants are the same. We know infants at least as young as 2 months can discriminate different patterns. And we know that somewhere between 6 and 12 months of age, infants become tuned into particular metrical structures in the music that they're hearing in their environment. So infants are sensitive to rhythm structure. And the question is, will movement influence here's Jessica bouncing a baby in dimple time. In most of our studies, we lose a lot of babies or they don't like what we're asking them to do. But in these studies, they really love to be bounced, and that, you know, makes us think again that this is a really important behavior. So here's, normally we would use different infants in the twos and the threes, but just for demo purposes, but the same behavior. So Jessica came up with this contraption, which is a seesaw. And the person lies down on the seesaw and we put them with the seesaw. So we can bounce them in this line of second beat or third beat. And when you do this, you get the effect. Okay? If they were moved in the second beat, then they say that's what they heard. And if they were moved in third beat, then they say that's the triple pattern. So we're works in adults with passive movement. Now, what about the vestibular system? I'm very interested in the vestibular system for a few reasons. One is that it develops really early. So, you know, a young infant is pretty floppy and unable to coordinate muscle movement very well. But their vestibular system is quite well developed. That's why, you know, in the earliest days, even they like to be held, they like to be moved, they like to be watched. That's why, you know, those of us who remember having young children, we spent hours walking with them because that movement calmed them down. That's because their vestibular system was developed, and they were able to use that input to regulate their state. And of course, the vestibular input remains very strong during passive movement when some of these other aspects of movement are not nearly so strong. So we wanted to look at the vestibular system. And so our first attempt at doing this, we decided, well, the vestibular system, of course, is located in the inner ear. So if your vestibular system is only activated if your head is moved. So we thought, well, we've got our seesaw, so what if we put people's feet on the seesaw and we simply move their feet up again in time versus we keep the rest of their body fairly still, but we now mostly move their head up and down as the seesaw moves. Well, if you move only their legs, we don't get any chance with that to hear the auditory advice and effect on each of those two interpretations they make at the end of each rhythm pattern. But if we move their head, we do. Okay, so that indicates that maybe, you know, that's consistent with the vestibular system being really important in this. And then we did another experiment where we actually stimulated the vestibular system directly. Okay, so you can do this if you put little electrodes behind the ears. The vestibular nerve comes very close to the surface back there. And so if you give little electrical impulses, it stimulates the vestibular nerve and sends that information up to your brain. And if you just sort of stimulate the vestibular nerve randomly, you have a sense of disorientation, the room kind of moves, and you don't have a sense of where you are. And that's what most of these studies using this technique do. They're visual studies, and they're interested in the effects on the visual system. But we found that if we were to alternately stimulate left and right sides, the effect you get is one of the head going back and forth. So your head is actually stationary, but you feel like your head is moving back and forth like this. Okay? So you have a sensation of movement, but in fact, it's that sensation of movement is only coming in through the vestibular system. Okay? And now just because when you do the stimulation, you have a slight sort of pricking sensation on the skin, so we had to make sure that that tactile sensation is not what was driving it, so we did the same thing on the elbows. Okay, so you feel a slight prickling on the elbows, but no stimulation of the vestibular system. And when you do this, when we stimulate the vestibular system, so we do it half the subjects every second beat, half the subjects every third beat, what you find is whatever way they were stimulated, that influenced how they heard the pattern. If they were stimulated so that this went back and forth, felt like this went back and forth every second beat, then they said that what they heard was a march. And if this was stimulated so you felt it going back and forth in therapy, then they said they were lost. Okay. But the group stimulated on the elbows didn't show any significant bias in one of them. So it seems then that the vestibular system is sufficient to affect, stimulation of the vestibular system is sufficient to affect your interpretation of rhythm patterns. How does learning come into all of this? Well, we're just in the midst of conducting a study, which is the preliminary results so far, where we're looking at children who are studying theater music, and we'll have many of you are familiar with that, but it's a program for moms and young children, and we're looking at the baby classes. And in these classes, the kids listen to music, and the mothers hold the babies, and they march to the rhythm of the music, and so the babies are experiencing a lot of movement and music in these classes. So we thought that if this is having an effect on what the kids are learning, they should show stronger effects than our children who are not taking any music classes. Interestingly, we're not finding stronger effects, but what we are finding is, and these kids, which we see in our adults, but we haven't ever seen in our infants, other infants, not taking these classes, is they show a much stronger effect in the duple phase than in the triple phase. So when we stimulate, when we give them movement that's in twos, then they show a whopping effect to prefer the octave students afterwards as in twos. But if we stimulate, we give them movements in threes, they show a very moderate effect. And when you look at what they're playing for the kids in kinder music classes, it's predominantly music that's in twos rather than in threes. And in fact, in Western music in general, it's predominantly twos. We divide things predominantly into twos rather than into threes. And so I think what the theater music classes are doing is accelerating that learning, that bias from two over three. And so yes, they're getting, I think it's an interesting conclusion because they're getting more musical stimulation. Yes, they're showing some superior effects, but they're also showing a narrowing of their music listening biases based on what they're hearing, which is, you know, what we expect. That's what happened. That's what enculturation is all about. But I think it means that in music education, we have to be careful what we're playing together with, because it's really affecting. You know, if you want to have kids who are equally happy with threes or fives or sevens, then you probably have to start in the infancy period and exposing them to that if you want optimal results. Okay, so what we can conclude then is that there is a strong early interaction between musical rhythm and movement, and it involves in a vestibular sense. And perhaps musical experience originates in rhythmic body movement. So perhaps the first music that as human beings can experience is actually movement rather than sound. Okay, so let's move now to pitch structure and examine how infants process spectral structure and how that develops. And I'll start just with a little bit of sort of background studies on sort of why pitch is important and what practices it's involved in terms of social and emotional development. And then I'll get into some details on how kids acquire musical pitch from consonants to celestial harmony. And then I'll go into some of our studies of how the brain is responding, particularly how auditory cortex is responding to individual tones, to patterns, and to virtual pitch as the infant develops over the first months. Okay, so I've said a few times during the talk that mothers and fathers sing to infants in high-pitched voice. They talk to them with what we call musical speech, you know, this highly affected speech that we use with infants. It also has high pitch. And the question is, why do caregivers use high pitch when interacting with babies? And my linguist friends tell me it probably has to do with helping them learn language. And so we thought about it, and we thought, well, actually, if you think about one aspect of language learning, which is discriminating vowels, you'd actually predict that high pitch should make it more difficult to discriminate vowels. And this is the reason. If you have a high-pitched voice compared to a low-pitched voice, with a high-pitched voice, the harmonics, of course, are integer, multiple, fundamental. So if you have a high fundamental, the harmonics are going to be more widely spaced with the high-pitched voice than they are with the low-pitched voice. If you then look for affirmance, so what distinguishes one vowel from another, it's what we call performance, which are resonances. So when you say ah versus e, your mouth is in a different position, right? So the ah, your mouth is very open, the e, your mouth is quite closed, and the lips are drawn back. So the oral cavity in your mouth is a different shape. And what that means is in the two vowel sounds, the resonances, the part of the signal that is amplified, is in a different frequency range in the two. Okay, so we call those resonances affirmance. And affirmance are just resonances, so they may fall near an actual harmonic where there's energy, or they may fall between harmonics. But you would have to make the prediction that if your harmonics are close together, it should be easier to figure out where the formant resonance is than if your harmonics are widely spaced. Mm-hmm. And the other prediction that you make, which I think I have one for, is that if you put a pitch contour in, so if you change the pitch of your vowel as you say it, then not only the pitch of the fundamental, but the pitch of all of the components change. But the format remains relatively constant. So at some point, the energy is going to go through that resonance, and you're going to have a really good take on where that resonance is. So you make a prediction then that pitch contour should help vowel discrimination. But they actually using high pitch should make it harder. So we wanted to test this in infants. How are we going to do this? Well, now we're moving from the preference procedure to a conditioned head turn procedure. And what happens in this case is everything is from one side. And again, we flash, sorry, we present in this case, say, one vowel over and over again. Say ah, so we do ah, 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 all kinds of different examples of ah. And then occasionally we change it to e. Okay? And when we change it to e, the infant's task is to look at the speaker on the side where the sound is coming from, and if they do that, then we'll light up a toy that jumps up and down and is a reward for them. So we basically condition them to turn their head when there's a change. And we can train them to do this by making them change very loud and say, and so on. And once they've caught it, then we move in and test our two vowel sounds. And when we do this, indeed, when we put a pitch contour on versus a steady state vowel, the infants perform much better. So that the pitch contour helps them, but within both the contour and the steady state conditions, they do better discriminating vowels with a low pitch voice than a high pitch voice. So when we talk to babies in a high pitch voice, it's not helping them to discriminate vowels. In fact, it's hurting them in discriminating vowels. So why do we do it? Well, the reason we use high pitch probably has to do with emotional expression. And so this is really important. Infants have to get out this pitch information because it's telling them about how they feel. It's helping the parent to regulate their state, and it's helping them in interaction with the parents when they're in a pre-verbal condition where they don't have language to communicate. And so just to bring this home, there are all kinds of studies of infant record speech, hundreds and hundreds, probably thousands actually, of studies of various aspects of infant-directed speech. And what they do when they look, they compare infant-directed speech to adult-directed speech, and they use naturalistic infant-directed speech, which is highly emotional. Usually when you're talking to the baby, you're expressing an emotion. And they compare that to adult-directed speech that's unemotional, so it's somebody reading from a textbook. And they have these whopping differences between infant-directed and adult-directed speech. So we were interested in showing that maybe these things that we're seeing in the infant-directed speech, these pitch differences that we're seeing in the infant-directed speech, are related to emotional expression. And maybe you see very similar things if you look at emotional adult-directed speech. So that's what we did. We took emotional infant-directed speech, normal infant-directed speech, and emotional adult-directed speech, and we compared them. And so in every case, we had moms come in and they said the phrase, "Hey, honey, come over here." And they said it six times, three times to their infant, expressing love, comfort, fear, and surprise, and then three times to an adult experimenter, expressing those same three emotions. Okay, so they said the phrase six times, expressing three different emotions to their infant and to the other experimenter. And what you'll see with these pitch contours is that the adult-directed ones are black, and the infant-directed ones are in blue, they're very similar. So when you look at adult-directed emotion, you express it with using infant-directed techniques when it's in the sense of one. Here's what some of them sound like. So this is adult-directed love comfort. And listen for those downward pitch contours.
"Hey, honey, come over here."
So you hear how the pitch goes down? And the infant-directed,
"Hey, honey, come over here."
So you get those same pitch contours in both cases. Fear is pretty flat in terms of pitch. Here's the adult directed.
"Hey, honey, come over here."
And the infant.
"Hey, honey, come over here."
And surprise, you get these large bell-shaped contours.
"Hey, honey, come over here." Hey, honey, come over here.
So there are differences between them, but the pitch is very consistent. So we think that what's going on with the pitch that we see in Osipa, in infant-directed speech has to do with emotional expression. You put these sort of musical characteristics in because it's expressing emotion. And do babies hear about it? Yes, they do. Work by Jim Morgan and Kathy Best and their colleagues. And also, in terms of singing, we've done studies showing that emotion really matters. I'm going to go into details on this, but emotion really matters in terms of what it feels like. The more loving the tone of voice, the more they like it. And they always like the high pitched version better than the low pitched version of singing, as well as speech. So that was just kind of a little background about pitch processing and why it's so important, because it's really intimately involved in communication between babies and parents. So, what about musical pitch, learning musical pitch structure? Well, we've come up with a sort of model that integrates a lot of studies that we've done. And this is the basic way it goes. Sensory consonants and dissonance is quite similarly perceived across musical systems. It's very dependent on peripheral mechanisms, and therefore we predicted and found that it would be very early to develop. So we think that musical pitch structure probably originates in terms of sensory consonants and dissonance across all musical systems. Then you get to things like higher levels of pitch structure in music, like scales. And pretty much every musical system is based on scales, but the scales differ a lot from musical system to musical system. They're more dependent on central mechanisms, and so they're going to take some time to develop and have to learn them. And then when you get to harmony, it's probably of these three things the least similar across musical systems. In fact, some people would say that Western musical structure is the only musical system that has a very complex harmonic structure. It's going to be even more dependent on central mechanisms, and you'd expect it to develop quite late. So we have this progression then from early sensitivity to consonants and dissonance, and then later development to sensitivity to scales and harmony. You all know what I mean when I say consonants and dissonance.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to say yes or no.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, I'll just really briefly go through this. This is why I said that consonants and dissonance really originates in very peripheral mechanisms. If you look at the basal membrane in the structure in the cochlea, and you stretch it out so that it's not spiral, different places along its length respond to different pieces, respond maximally to different frequencies. So you have different frequencies encoded along its length. And if you look at ratings of consonants and dissonance, what you find is, for sine wave tones, up to about a minor third, you get fairly dissonant ratings. And then above that, you get fairly consonant ratings. Which corresponds to, on the basal membrane, the ability to form separate representations for two simultaneous tones. So if you present two sine waves at the same time, and they're greater than a major third apart, a minor third apart, then you get two quite distinct bumps or patterns on the basal membrane, and that they're quite separated. But if they're less than a minor third apart, you get interference patterns right on the basal membrane. Now, for complex sounds that have overtones, like this A2 and this C#3, so they have energy not only at their fundamental, but at integer multiples, they'll create very complex patterns on the basal membrane. But whenever you get components that are close together, they're going to create interference patterns on the basal membrane. And in fact, there are temporal models as well, and you get similar things going on in the temporal firing patterns of the auditory nerve. So right at these very peripheral levels, there's differentiation in how consonant intervals and dissonant intervals are encoded. So because it's so peripheral, we expect it to show up very early, and in fact it does. This is a little video from an infant who's doing our conditioned head turn procedure. And so what happens is you'll hear a bunch of different consonant intervals being played, and then occasionally we'll throw in a dissonant interval, and you'll see her task is to turn her head when it's a dissonant interval. And so this is just showing that infants can discriminate consonant and dissonant intervals. To get acclimatized to learn, they acculturate to the scales of their culture, and they don't have it in the first few months. And in terms of harmony, we added one more change, which is this change. So we changed that same note, that G to an A. Now the A is within the key, right? It's still within the key of C, but when you play this one, it still sounds wrong because it's not going to rhyme in black harmony. Okay, so if this change pops out at you, that means you have a good sense of implied harmony. And so here's data for adults. Both the change that goes outside the key, the change that stays within the key but goes outside the harmony, are both those changes are easy. They pop out compared to the change that stays within the harmony and the key. And we get the same pattern in 7-year-olds, but in 5-year-olds we don't. So this is the key one here. So the out of harmony change doesn't pop out in the 5-year-olds. So kids without musical training, somewhere between 5 and 7, they start to develop this sensitivity. And since then, there's been similar results that Schellenberg is showing, and Stefan Kolsch's group as well. So this is our basic, in a nutshell, what seems to be going on in terms of the musical pitch structure. Everything seems based initially on the sensory consonants and dissonance. Kids learn scales somewhere before 5 years, we don't know when. And harmony takes quite a while to learn. So basic stuff that I've shown here, they get by, say, age 7. Costa Guillaume and other people have shown some aspects of harmony. It's maybe 10 to 12 years without musical training, so 10 to 12 years before you're showing sensitive to it. So I'm throwing a lot of stuff at you because I wanted to just sort of give you an overview of the work that we're doing. So I'm going to switch gears slightly now and talk about how pitch is encoded in early infancy. And there are four questions that I'm going to address. So the first one has to do with the reference process relative or absolute or both pitch. So how do they encode pitch? How do they represent pitch? And then we're going to go into our brain studies on cortical responses to pitch changes, cortical responses to pitch patterns, and processing of virtual pitch, which is the same fundamental. Okay, relative and absolute pitch codes. Well, as I'm sure most of you are aware, most people can't, they're not very good at naming the pitch of isolated tones. When people can do this in an effortless fashion, we say they have absolute pitch. Although it's a little more complicated than that, because you can have pitch memory, which I think is something different than absolute pitch. So you can have good pitch memory for quite a few number of songs and so on. But most people don't have access to the pitch of isolated tones. And most of us recognize melodies based on the relative pitch. So we look at the integral sizes between notes, and that's what we encode, that we have access to in memory. And that's actually quite amazing when you think about it. Relative pitch, even though people talk about absolute pitch a lot as this amazing thing, in fact, relative pitch is a much more sophisticated ability, because you're looking at relations between things, and it allows you to do a lot more than absolute pitch. It allows you to recognize tunes when they're played in different keys, and that's a very valuable skill to have. But it's a little bit surprising when you look at what we know so far about the auditory system, that we are so bad at absolute pitch. And this is why, so right from your ear through all these subcortical, and we'll do the details, all these subcortical way stations, right into your auditory cortices, there are maps of frequency. Okay, so this is actually from cortex. And the high frequencies are encoded over here, and then the low frequencies over here, and so on. So you need these reversals of maps and so on. So right into the primary auditory and cortical areas, we have these frequency maps, and they're absolute maps. Okay? So that absolute pitch information is there in your auditory cortex. And when you hear a sound, it's right there. And yet, when you encode that into memory, somehow that absolute information
is not very forward. At least not for most of us. So the question is, for infants who don't have much of a functioning brain, whether their cortical, their cortex is highly immature, and they rely a lot on subcortical processing, so you might expect relative pitch to be something that, that would be difficult for them. But in fact, that's not what we found. So, for instance, in this study, we wanted to look at long-term memory tonalities and to see whether infants if they remembered the absolute pitch of the values or if they recorded the relative pitch. And so we had them listen to two melodies at home for 7 days. And then they came into the lab and we gave them a preference test. And what they heard in the preference test, in the control group, they heard either the melody that they heard at home or the melody that they didn't hear at home. And they preferred to listen in this case to the melody that they didn't hear before. So they showed a novelty preference. And so they didn't matter which melody they had, they preferred to listen to the other one. They were sick of hearing that one every day, 7 times a day for a week. Then we transposed the melodies from the beginning. So they listened in one key at home and then transposed to a different key when they came in, and they showed the same effect. And they still preferred to listen to the novel melodies over the familiar one. So they didn't care what the absolute pitch was. They recognized the melody of transposition. So they could clearly do it in relative pitch. We then thought maybe they'll do absolute pitch as well. So what we did in this condition, they listen to a melody at home, and then when they come in, you know, they have the two melodies that, that we're preparing, and we compare two versions of that same melody they heard at home. So the melody at the pitch level they heard at home and the new pitch level, and they couldn't care less. Now that doesn't tell us they're not doing absolute pitch, it just tells us that they don't care about it. And they were perfectly happy to listen to the melody in the pitch they heard at home or in the new pitch. But it suggests that it just isn't a salient feature of the melody, but the absolute pitch really just doesn't matter to them. So then we looked at it in a different way, and this was based on some work that Ross had done with adults. Because one of the problems, of course, in measuring absolute pitch with people who are not musicians is they can't tell you that the note is a C or a D because they don't have labels for the note. So I don't know if you want to call this absolute pitch test or just a pitch of whether you have very good memory. But this is how the test goes. So we play these what we call standard notes, and occasionally we change one up or down tone. And they're separated by 2.5 seconds. Okay? So in the first condition, all they hear is the standard tones. In the second condition, we put in 3 interference, randomly chosen interference tones, then 5, and then 15. Okay, when you get to 15, it starts to get difficult. For the infant version, it's actually not that difficult because we made the standard tones louder. So I'll just play some of these. This is what it sounds like with no interference. Okay, so that note the infant would turn her head, this is a connecting picture, and so on. By the time you get to 15, it sounds like this. In our heads. Every parent has asked this, and you
I'll tell you afterwards when I have difficult notes to run, how little data you get from every thing, you know. But I don't want to go there right now. But this is much better to use DG. And so in this particular study, very basic study, we just want to know, can we measure a cortical response to a change in pitch? So we have our EEGI nets that go on in about 5 minutes, and we can measure 128 channels across the head. And so in the first, in this first study, we presented just the note C, piano tone, 80% of the trials, and then 20% of the time, we changed it to C sharp. It's a really, really simple study in the mind of the measure of cortical responses. When you do this in adults, you get a response that's called a mismatch negativity. It occurs about 150 to 200 milliseconds after the onset of the tone that's changed. And you only get it when you put occasional changes in. So it's as if the auditory system builds up a representation of this repeated tone. And then when you change it, it has to update that representation, and you get this additional response called the mismatch negativity. So what happens in our infants? Well, this is just to show you, I won't show you all of the data, though we've analyzed all of it. I'm just going to show you one electrode at the front of the head, and you might wonder why I'm showing you an electrode at the front of the head when I'm interested in the auditory cortex, and which is in here. And so the reason is that our cortex sort of sits around a ciliary fissure. And so the what you measure in EEG is the depolarization and firing of neurons. And so you only measure something, you only get an electrical field that's big enough to measure at the surface. You have a whole bunch of neurons whose axons are all lined up in the same direction as going from one layer to another of cortex. And they fire at the same time. A bunch of fire at the same time. So that's basically what we measure. So we have a big brain with a whole bunch of neurons that are lined up in the same direction that are firing at the same time. And because it's around a ciliary fissure, the axons are sort of pointing this way. So an event that happens in auditory cortex, you tend to get, say, negativity at the front and a positivity at the back, the two ends of the electrical field, or the reverse of positivity here and negativity here. So we look at the front of the head when we're interested in what's going on in auditory cortex. And I'll start with our formicles. Now these are difference waves. So this is the onset of the tone. And then this is the brain's response across time to in seconds. So this is a quarter of a second here. And these are difference waves. So we have a wave, an average that we get to the standard, the C's. And then we have the occasional C sharps, and we have another average wave that's a response to the C sharp. So if we take the difference between those two waves, at about 0.2 seconds, we get this big negativity here that looks a lot like a mismatch negativity in adults. And so this is at 4 months. In adults, it occurs at about 150 milliseconds, so it's a bit later. But the waveform looks very similar. We can see something like this, but it's very small at 3 months. But if you go to 2 months, you see basically no hint of that. Maybe it's a tiny bit there, but nothing significant. And instead, what you see is this large positive wave. Now, that is telling us that something is really changing dramatically from 2 months and 4 months of age, and how the auditory cortex is responding to this thing. The fact that this is significantly above zero is telling us that the infants are detecting that change. They're telling the C from the C sharp, their brain is responding to that change, but it's doing it in a completely different way than at 4 months of age. And we still don't entirely understand what's going on with all of this, but I think we need to look at it in terms of anatomical data, and there's very little developmental anatomical data in humans. So this is one of the studies done on epilepsy cases. And what you see here, this is a fetus between 2 and 4 months, is the development of these neural connections in auditory cortex. Okay, so now we know that we can get a cortical response to a change in pitch, we can start to ask slightly more interesting questions, like what about a pattern, a change in a pattern? So in this case, we have
general notes that go up, and then occasionally you reverse it, the notes go down, and then it's up. So in this case, it's really two notes that are along the moments. So we expect responses to both of these two notes, mismatch-like responses to both of these two notes. And what do we get? Well, at 4 months, that's exactly what we get. So these are the standard ingenuine ways to think about that. These are the difference ways we subtract them. We get this mismatch-like response here to the first note. This is the opposite of the second note. And we get a mismatch-like response to the opposite of the second note. We look at the two intervals and we get a flat line. So what this is telling us is even though we're getting those slow wave responses to a change in pitch, we haven't changed the pitch here because the two pitches are the same. We've only changed the order of the two pitches. When we change the order of the two pitches, we're not getting a cortical response in two intervals. Yet we know they can do a lot of things. They can just bring in speech sounds. They can do a lot. But this suggests that maybe some of what they're doing at least is subcortical, or else we just don't have a sensitivity to measure what they're doing. That's always a possibility as well. But what this definitely tells us is between 2 and 4 months, there are huge changes again going on in what is being represented in auditory cortex. And I'll just give you one more example. Do you all know what virtual pitch is? Virtual pitch, or just pitch of the missing fundamental? Yes, no, no.
Yes.
Yes? Any no's?
No.
No. Oh, a couple of no's. Okay. So basically, you know, a sound is made up of a bunch of harmonics that are integer multiples of the fundamental frequency. And we extract the pitch not only based on the fundamental, but based on all of the options as well. And if you take out, in fact, the fundamental pitch, then so you have only the overtones, the pitch of the sound doesn't change. The timbre changes a little bit, but you still hear that same pitch, even though that fundamental frequency isn't there. Without going into details, the basic reason is that the repetition period of the whole waveform doesn't change when you take out the fundamental. So pitch is complicated. You don't just extract the pitch from the lowest harmonic that's there, but you integrate all of the harmonics into your perceptive pitch. So pitch is not a physical thing. Pitch is a psychological thing. Frequency is a physical thing, but pitch actually we create in our nervous system. So what we wanted to know is with babies, if we take out the fundamental, are they going to hear the pitch of the missing fundamental or virtual pitch? Well, virtual pitch is that pitch isn't actually present, but frequency isn't actually present. So here's what we did. 6 of the 7 pairs of notes are standard. So here's one note. It's got a fundamental frequency and some harmonic structure, and that varied. The pitch of the notes and their harmonic structure varied from the first note to the second note, sorry, across the 6 pairs. And then the second note of each pair went up. Okay, so again, this harmonic structure varied from pair to pair, but the second note is always higher in pitch than the first note. Okay, so just you always have a rising pitch. But then from one time in 7, what we did was exactly the same thing. A bunch of harmonics in here, every harmonic increases in pitch, but we set up these harmonics now so that they are in the right ratios to create a virtual pitch that you hear down here. And if you can hear that virtual pitch, this will sound like it's going down. If you can't hear virtual pitch, this will sound like it's going up. Okay? So you have a set of things that go up and up and up. And did you hear that one down? Okay. If you heard that one down, you're doing virtual pitch because actually all the harmonics went up from the first tone to the second tone. So we first did this in adults, and indeed, here's the onset. So the first tone is not unexpected, but the second tone, when it goes down in pitch, is not expected, right? Mm-hmm. And we get a nice mismatch response to that second tone, only when it goes down in pitch. What about our infants?
where two-month-olds are not showing responses to change in pitch pattern at cortical level, and they're not showing sensitivity to the change in fundamental. But those things are there for 4 months. Cortical responses, but there could be other stuff going on separately. So, somebody should have told me to be quiet. So we can conclude that there are large changes in the functioning of the cortex between 2 and 4 months. By 4 months, cortex encodes pitch patterns, encodes pitch of instant fundamental. And so at a young age, by 4 months, infants are able to combine harmonics to form complex percepts. Now, I do have another section, but I think I probably should stop here. If you'd rather ask questions, I'd rather have me talk to you.
Pardon? Vote for
talk? I'm going to vote for talk. How many vote for dinner? Okay, I won't be insulted if you leave. Okay, I'll go through this really quickly. This is just a little bit of a few studies on effects now, specific musical experience on brain development. So this is sort of a hot topic at the moment. Does music have effects on auditory cortex? Does it have effect on language, on mathematics, and so on? And so what we started to look at this a number of years ago, we decided the first thing we needed to do was understand the developmental progression. So how do basic sensory representations change across development? Because if we don't know that, we can't look for effects of specific experience. So the components I'm showing you before are responses to change. And those come in very early. But interestingly, the basic responses to just, I present you a sound, I present you a piano tone, and I look at your basic just response to that tone, those responses take a very long time to mature. So in this study, we just presented flight tones, piano tones, and violin tones, and just measured what's the response to those tones. Nothing sophisticated here whatsoever. And the basic responses you get to these are P1, N1, P2, we call it the first positive component, second, first negative component, second positive component. And you get this complex, this is about 50 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds, close to 200 milliseconds after the other side of the tone. And for years, people did studies like this in adults and said, these components have to be present, and they say that the sounds go into auditory cortex. Okay? They're obligatory components. Well, if you measure in kids around 4 to 5 years of age, you can hardly measure them. They're so tiny. And we haven't been able to measure them in kids that are younger than 4 years of age. So what's going on? And then when we look, so really the piano tones were their most robust, well, because of the sharp onset of the piano tones. They get bigger and bigger, and they reach a maximum of about 10 to 12 years of age, and then they get smaller. And they reach adult levels, they're still the less adults, but they reach adult levels about 18 years of age. So this is a very protracted development of this component.
Sorry, I'm just wondering, and at 44 subjects only? Average?
Oh, no, yes, actually, yes, this is, there's 5 subjects in this unit. Okay. 6, 5, 4, 4, yeah. So, right, so it's not a huge number of subjects. but actually, this was obviously replicated now by Ross Everyman in this group, and they get almost identical So, what's going on? Well, I think what this says is that these are not just simple sensory components, right? Because kids at four years of age, they're talking, they're singing, they're doing all kinds of things. These can't be simple sensory components. I think what they are representing is actually feedback from other areas back to auditory areas. And that's what's immature in kids, is this sort of top-down executive functioning attentional control. We have a whole bunch of studies in adults that I can't tell you about, but basically we find all kinds of differences between adult musicians and non-musicians, and one of the most robust findings is this P2 component is way bigger their actual musical training. So how are you going to look at this? Well, a start is to start to look at children who are taking music lessons. And in fact, children 4 and 5 years of age who are studying Sisyphean music show different responses from their peers. So the dark lines here are the Suzuki kids, and the white lines are the non-Suzuki kids that they're taking, you know, fully involved in sports and other things. It's not that they're sitting at home doing nothing. But you see much bigger N1 and P2 in the kids already 4 or 5 years of age. Now that still doesn't tell you that it was experience that did that. Maybe the kids who are taking music lessons were born with better brains. More likely, I think, is that the kids with music lessons were in musical, in homes. Parents who put their kids in music lessons young tend to have a lot of music in the home, so these kids are exposed to a lot of music early on. So what we decided to do in this study was look at changes over a year. This is the last study I showed you. So if we can see differential change over the year, kids are taking lessons and kids are not taking lessons, that's stronger evidence that the music lessons have something to do with it. So I'll just show you one slide from this study. This is the group of Suzuki kids. Oh, we used MEG, by the way, instead of EG, but it's similar, but it looks like magnetic responses. These are the Suzuki kids, these are the untrained kids. And these are the average responses to violin sounds across the 4 sessions. So every 3 months, we did a measurement in it. And you can see that they, you know, they're similar, but they change, these responses change across the session. And if you look at the variance across session, that tells you where the biggest change is happening across the year. And they're right here, which is right here. And this component here turns out to be like an N2 component that's related to attention. So the biggest changes that we're seeing in the children taking music lessons that differentiates them from the kids who are not taking music lessons seems to be in components that have to do with attention to sing, which I think is fascinating because you know, studies like those of Glenn Schellenberg that suggest that music lessons have a sort of general beneficial effect on other cognitive functions. So it seems like it improves math skills, language skills, you know, it sort of improves all of cognition a little bit. And if you think about a mechanism, how could that happen? Well, a good mechanism would be attention and executive function. So if music is actually training executive functions, then that's something you can apply in all kinds of situations, and it's going to help you learn no matter what the situation. So I think that's what's happening to whatever extent there's a benefit of musical training that generalizes to other cognitive functions. I think it's because of not something sort of about music itself, although it has to do with music, but it's because music trains these executive functions. Okay, then I will stop there. I'm going to show the conclusions. Or the take-home message. And I'll just go straight to, there are many, many people who work on this, but these are a few of the